For almost a decade, on my TV show Interview with Ed, I've been interviewing extra-dimensional beings and consciousnesses from a number of different realms. Many of my questions have been answered, but with every answer comes more questions. Join me on my ongoing quest to find out, who are we? Why are we here? And where are we going? All right. Good morning, everybody. Good afternoon. Welcome, Miss Welcome Z. It's Earthstar. How's it going?
Hello. It's going well. I do invite y'all to come on camera and hang out. I got gallery view going on today, so I'm excited.
Perfect. Yeah, we're going to... So I was kind of wanting to first play catch up. You and I, we've been catching up over the past few weeks or so, but play catch up for the audience who may have only seen your interview that I did with you. And if they're not following you regularly, then we kind of have some catch up to do. So I figured we do that first, and then we can just open the door and go into the plethora of subjects that I'm sure we could talk about for hours and hours.
Open the gates.
So first off, you're now in Canada, correct?
Yes, I am in Canada. I'm actually Canadian. I just blew into my Saturn return this year, turned 28. So my bubble of being in the new age and being all spiritual has bursted, and I've landed back on Earth. Quicker, there is all sorts of different things that are involved in building the new Earth, as we say. So it's pretty exciting. I truly did not see this coming, but now that I'm here, it all makes sense. So,
well, you're also recently a mother, correct?
Yes, I gave birth April 13 to a little girl. Her name is Kara. She just grew two little teeth on the bottom of her mouth. So that's pretty exciting. She also bites now too. So that's also exciting.
And I'm sure that's helping sort of bring you back to Earth a little bit.
That
whole experience.
Kind of. I mean, she came to Earth with this massive golden cord of light to source through her crown. So she's been landing that cord through me and my husband. And so, oh, it's been like a nonstop psychedelic trip since she's been born. But in other ways, she's definitely been grounding us as well in the Earth reality. So,
well, you talked in our interview, we talked about Kara. Kara One, right? How do you label those experiences? But yeah, Kara One in the interview.
Part one.
That was sort of... talked about and then things shifted. It was shortly after that visit, we were visiting you, we were filming for the Skull Project, and then we got on the road, and then the next time I talked to you, things had totally changed. All of a sudden you're getting married in front of the skull in Shasta by our friend Heather. And her husband at the time, Matthew, and that's shifted drastically too. So,
yeah. We're just timeline slip and slide and all over the place these days.
Yeah. That was, I'm, doing some editing last night, late on the Skull Project, and, just the amount of shifts that, people have been going through in their personal lives in just a short amount of time. It's phenomenal. From just my documentation of these types of, you guys. So, it's great. It's awesome to see, because it's turbulent, but yet there's so much growth and happiness that seems to be occurring during these, big shifts.
Yeah. I mean, I'm sure I would love to share with your audience just kind of that little transition there, because it was kind of pivotal. Yep. And I feel like you meet so many people, and only in hindsight do you really notice like the kind of unique connections sometimes, because, Ruben, I met Ruben through a mutual friend of ours, Harlan, and he's like, oh, Ruben makes this cool documentaries and he interviews cosmic people. I'm like, oh, that's cool. And so, you know, around the equinox, he texts me. He's like, hey, I'm making this documentary with the skull. We're going around doing grid work. Can we come over to your land? And I was like, oh, well, yeah, come on over. I guess we can re-record our episode while we're here. So that was a general plan that we made. And then the day that the skull, I think this was like the day before the equinox that you guys rolled into town.
Yep.
I had this crazy fever. It was like, I felt like it was like one of the weirdest fevers I've ever had. I was delirious. Ruben's friend, what's his name again? Zach, right? Who made the music.
Yep.
So he had Zach make music. So he sampled my voice and made this like really incredible, like trippy music. And so as I'm in the depth of this feverish delirium, Zach sends me this song, and it's basically this like remixed trippy sound of my own voice. And then I'm flying out and I'm, you know, just tripping balls, and like Kara comes, he's like, I'm coming back. And I'm like, what? She's like, I'm coming back. And like the skull, and then Ruben texts me. He's like, we just got to town. We just got here. It was all just this very cinematic moment. And at that time, I think I was still a bit in denial. I was like, oh, like, does she mean we're going to be working together, or is she going to be back in the spirit realm or whatever? So then the next couple of days, they come over with the skull. And of course, Bill, he's doing a session with me. He's like, I see these hundreds of avatar babies flying around you. And he goes, I think you're going to be with child soon. I was like, wait, what? And then 3 days later, my current husband emailed me. He was like a student in my school prior to that. And he's like, hey, I really need a session. And so like a few days after the skull left, I ended up connecting with this man. And then the rest was history. So then I met him in person finally in June. And this was not an accurate reflection of my character, really, but I got pregnant like 3 weeks.
Well, yeah.
It was like an orchestration, you know, like I'm usually so like in my energy, and I was, you know, still with my previous partner at that point, where which I created Kara number one with, I guess, whatever language around that. So it was just this crazy timeline shift. It was like this massive collision. So I got pregnant in July. And we planned this grid work trip. So I do this dragon line trip. I did it for 2 years in a row. Basically, the dragon lines are the biggest ley line systems around the earth. There are 12 or 15 lines. I think they're supposed to be 24. They're just not online totally yet, or they've not yet been discovered. But essentially, at that point, I hadn't scientifically confirm these lines yet, but I was guided to run this particular line across the U.S. And at that point, we started in Mount Shasta, and I decided to do this again. And I end up in Mount Shasta, and Bill was there with the skull. And on the Lion's Gate, it was the day after, so 8-9, I woke up in the morning, and I looked over at Shane, that's my husband's name. I was like, wouldn't it be funny if the skull married us today?
And oh, so that was your idea.
Hey, I was just like piecing, you know, sometimes like all the puzzle pieces are there and you're just like, wait, like, let me just use my critical thinking for a second and just like place all of the clues together. So then Bill texts me. He's like, hey, like, Ruben has this friend, and you're going to see Ruben like kind of at the glue that is kind of facilitating all this behind the scenes somehow. He's like, yeah, Ruben has this friend named Heather. She's amazing. She has this land. Her and her partner, you know, they're connected to the native guardians of this mountain. And we'd love for you guys to meet. So we end up at her shop, and they just look at us. And they're like, we have to take you to this sacred site that's sacred to our people. And we're like, okay, so we're going. We end up at this like beautiful twin tree. And it was Bill and Ruben's friends, Heather and Matthew, and Matthew starts banging this, you know, this drum, this medicine drum. And they're like, all right, the ancestors have brought us here today. We're just going to tune in and ask the spirits, you know, what is the highest outcome for our gathering? And then Heather They basically channel. They're like, all right, guys, like spirit said that we can marry you guys today here if you guys would like for us to facilitate the ceremony. And Bill's like, well, the skull's never officiated any weddings before, but, you know, the spirits think it's important for us to do this. So, like, I was, like, looking over at him, and he's looking at me. He's like, can we say no? Or, like, are we just cosmically? Or because at that point, we just met, like, in person 2 months before that, right? And while we'd already done a lot, like, we used to, like, merge light bodies and fly out into the cosmos and do all sorts of crazy grid work together. But it's different when you meet in person and, like, you're meeting the human personality for the first time. So we're just kind of like, well, I guess Kara and the skull and the mountain has facilitated and Ruben somehow. He's like, I don't know.
I got the call later. I was like, oh, okay. We get that on film?
Then I had to call Ruben. I'm like, Ruben, like, just never guess what happened.
Yeah, it was kind of shocking, but not really. When you're following the bill and the skull around, all kinds of crazy stuff happens. So shocking, but not really.
Yeah, right. It's not, but it's still it is too. Yeah. To our human, you're like, wait, which
right, and more stuff has happened since. But now you're in Canada and you're continuing your work. You had to play mom for a minute. And get that going. I guess that's ongoing. That'll never stop. So but what's exciting is the work that you're continuing to do with ley lines and healing the traumas. Recently, you just did a course. Can you explain what you did there? And where your work is sort of guiding you?
Yeah, it's very interesting. So I feel like my work, I would say that I'm a professional oracle, or I'm an oracle. I guess it's not really a profession. Mm-hmm. Here in the 3D, we would call it a profession, but that's not really what it is. I feel like there's a differentiation between an oracle and a channel, at least as I've been trained. And the main difference, as I'm discovering, is that, you know, channels basically, I feel like it's more of a technical process where you're psychically connecting to different energies and you're able to connect and be a channel for these energies and orate, so speak, communicate these energies into this world. And so I recently shared on my Instagram stories because I found this video of Abraham Hicks, or Esther Hicks, who channels Abraham. And in this clip, she was channeling basically the spirits of scientists. And she was saying, we're so excited for this vaccine. This vaccine is amazing. It's saving the world as a solution to COVID or whatever. And I was like, wait, right? And it's just this great example that oftentimes we place channels in this societal position where we listen to what they have to say. And I think this is a remnant of the ancient times when we did have a deep reverence for temple oracles. And channeling, as it is in his layman terms, is really a temple art. It is an art of the priest and priestess. It is an art of connecting in with higher dimensional energies. And this is the same art as shamanism, right? Shamanism is essentially the act of connecting in with higher dimensional energies and beings for the purpose of growth, receiving wisdom, and acquiring healing. So obviously that is the light or the cleanest way of interfacing with interdimensional energy. And of course, there's all other things that people do when they interface with interdimensional energy as well. So I feel like, with that being said, my training has been really around being like the purest vehicle for original creation energy as possible. So the only energies that I will channel as an oracle, my vessel is a sacred container that is reserved for Pachamama, Divine Mother Earth, and source creation and the guardian consciousness that work in alignment with those energies. And so I'm really just witnessing this immaculate story unfold. And I contacted Ruben about this because I want to film some sort of documentary because the earth is wanting to tell a story. And I feel like the story has to do with these new dragon lines that are coming online. This new dragon, crystalline, crystal, original creation consciousness that is wanting to come online. And so I guess you guys know from my interview with Ruben, my daughter, she really inspired a lot of this to come through. She is a master being that was carrying a lot of the original codes of creation, and she coached me and taught me. And we facilitated a couple of creation magic courses while I was pregnant with her both times. And essentially, we were opening this Stargate portal to original creation consciousness as she was coming through, and she had to weave back to the other side to complete the portal, essentially. And so this time, since she's come through, the fascinating thing is that we had planned for this over the 9/11 weekend. We wanted to do this planetary dragon line activation. And then the day before our event started, the queen died. I guess some people say like the queen was already dead or whatever. It doesn't really matter because it's all like a theater, right? It doesn't really matter. What matters is the collective consciousness. That's kind of the field that I work in. And so what this really told me was that there's an old consciousness, or the false queen consciousness, the false queen and king of tyranny system, and the human slavery mind control systems that the queen represented. It had to die in order for this new grid to actually fully come online, which we'd been talking about. I was just in awe because the earth was telling me like this new divine feminine true queen network was going to come online. And then I watched the queen die like the day before I even started. So I was just like really in awe. And then I feel like lately I've been working a lot with the original serpent energy of the earth. Like this original mother deity that we have as the earth, like her consciousness, she is actually like a living being. And how I see this is really similar to cosmic energies in incarnating. It's like there's one central spirit, and then she can actually emerge into the volcano and become a volcano goddess, or emerge into the rivers and incarnate as a river goddess, and so, or come into a human vessel and be a priestess, you know, where we're carrying these fibers of her. And then there's this fascinating like today, there was an assignment that just came in this morning. It was about this fallen Nephilim reversal artificial patriarchy kind of war that's been like siphoning on her. And it's very interesting. I hope I'm not just like going off on a tangent.
Yeah, I was going to say.
Just where I'm at today.
Oh, good. Is that the Sophia consciousness? Is that what we term that?
Consciousness. I think that is an incarnation of the one source Sophia Christ consciousness. I feel like, yeah, I've been really liking using the terms original creation just because it's pulling on just that clear energy before it differentiated, before it became, you know, individual forms.
And this is predating Lemuria consciousness, right? Before like Mu and Lemuria and those, when those consciousnesses were coming into Earth and filling Earth out. I think that's where the distortion started to happen around those times.
I think that it's very deeply connected to the Mu Lemuria consciousness. I also feel like these are very deep archetypal energies that humanity is working through right now, because we're essentially seeing, like, you sent me this idea of solar punk, which I loved, by the way. I like couldn't get enough of it. And I feel like it's this perfect marriage of the highest timelines of Atlantis and Mu. Because, I mean, when we really think about it, and I had this conversation with you, Ruben, I was like, I feel like in the New Age, a lot of times when we think about the New Earth, there's this like false architecture where people think we're going to go back to the caveman ages.
Right.
And there's a lot of things that sound good in theory. Like, and this is the thing, like the AI will attach itself to ideologies. It'll make things sound really good. It'll be like, oh, living in the forest with all your friends in a commune is what we want. But then what we really actually begin to think those things all the way through, we realize that it's easily those things will turn into communism or something.
Yeah.
But because, you know, a lot of star seeds, you know, we hated history class. And so we didn't really learn about like socialism and communism. We think that, oh, because we're awakened, we're going to get into a community and we're going to have heaven on earth. But what is the truth is that these distortions, they're in our DNA.
Yeah.
And so we're still going to have these things. We're just going to take all these things right into the commune, and it's going to organically turn into something that, you know, we'll probably blame negative aliens for down the line.
Yeah. Yeah. We were having kind of that conversation last week with Bridget. She was on, and I guess she had joined a commune type group or something for a minute and realized that it didn't work out so well. And we've seen that over and over again. You know, I know there's intentional communities that work out fairly decent, but when you start getting into those super closed groups, all kinds of drama comes up, and then there's, you know, power struggles and the same issues we're dealing with on a larger scale now, but they get more intense quicker because, you know, people, not saying that they don't work, I just know that it's a lot of work.
They can work. I think that we just, I don't remember whose quote this was, but I think it might be in The Art of War, where they say you shouldn't ever underestimate your enemy, which I think is the downfall oftentimes, where we're like, we're God and we're powerful star seeds and yay. And then it's like, well, I feel like my work has been really about discovering like what genetic degradation actually is and just how sneaky it has been, how sneakily it has infiltrated into our DNA and into our consciousness. And so bioregenesis, or the study of the restoration of our DNA and our light body, is so essential. And the CIA has done a great job at infiltrating our community enough that nobody actually is getting to the depth of this healing work and this level of bioregenesis or crystal DNA genetic work. And so like recently, the codes that have been coming through have to do with the restructuring of our densities 1, 2, and 3 energies, which in the false light New Age, we do a great job of saying, oh, the 3D is crumbling. We're going to the 5D. There's no such thing about 3D anymore. We're going to be in the heart. And well, it's like, okay, that's great. But everything that's human about us exists in the lower chakras. Actually, the whole point of ascension is for us, like biologically, would be to actually bring our consciousness into densities 1, 2, and 3, which is where all the distortions are. I guess not all the distortions, but most of the distortions that we see in our human beingness.
Right.
And so it has to do with the heart actually fractalizing its perfect geometry from the seed crystal into our human self, into our solar plexus and our sacral chakra and our root. And this is a horrific thing to do. It sucks. It is absolutely ridiculous, because you then really see the level of biospiritual abuse that has gone on this planet.
Okay.
And while people are really obsessed with secret space programs and being abducted and stuff, and even human trafficking. Like, what we realized then is that this whole planet has been a massive human trafficking ring. And if you've eaten a Pop-Tart, if you've gotten vaccinated, if you watched pornography or were exposed to Britney Spears on TV in passing, then you were trafficked, you know, on a consciousness, on an energetic level. And of course, that's not to scare anyone, because obviously you have a soul and your soul is a fractal of original source creation. So that original source creation is here to restructure, right? It's like only through that alignment and then allowing that light to fully fractalize through our human self, do we even start our journey in the path of liberation. And then only do we start on that path to true liberation can we really shine the light for humanity to do that as well. And it's just a lot. It's a lot.
We have
to fully realize just how deep it is.
I mean, in order to build a foundation, you have to find sturdy land, right? You build it on sand and it's going to fall apart. So you have to find good land and then tend to that land, right? And make sure that the land is going to be strong enough to hold your house, right? Your structure, whatever you're going to be building. So that's what we're doing right now is, you know, healing the land first so we can build new structures. And I feel that's where the whole idea of the new earth and your work and what I'm also sort of trying to preach and teach is these fundamental basics that we have a lot of work to do to, it's not like you said, you can't just bypass those lower chakras or those lower energies and just build a structure. Otherwise it's going to fall apart again.
It's kind of like we're on the battlefield and we're already at a disadvantage because we're not in our home field, right? We're like in the false matrix. Mm-hmm. And then they got a head start because by the time we woke up, they've already done what they have done to our DNA. We've already been massively programmed and all that stuff. So Annapurna says every path is individual as well. And absolutely. I feel like I am on this path of Christic biological ascension. This work that I'm doing is very specific and very particular. And I feel like it is basically the indigo mission. Like if you resonate with being an indigo, being a starseed, then we have this unified mission that has gone on for a really long time. That's basically the blue ray or the 144,000 founder flames. There's many.
I just found out I'm a blue ray.
Funny news. Like, wait,
what's that?
We've talked about this for like years or something.
Well, apparently there's an astrologer that Heather introduced me to, right, or took my charts or whatever, you know, my birth information to. In Joshua Tree here or Palm Desert in some renowned, apparently she was Liberace's astrologer at some point. And this old lady, I'm going to go meet her in person in a few weeks, but you know, I got a text back from Heather the other day. She's like, yep, you're a Blu-ray. You're in there. So I'm like, okay, that means.
It's fun.
But yeah, so sorry to interrupt, but yes, that there's a lot of work to do. We got a lot of work to do.
Yeah. I mean, because it has to do with coming home. Absolutely. Right. It's just all about where you want to go in one lifetime. And then if you don't get there in one lifetime, are you willing to commit to it for however many lifetimes it takes?
Right. Well, that was sort of the call, you know. Dolores's work talks about the different waves, right? The different souls that decided to come and incarnate at this time. And probably from the other side of the veil, it's just a quick little excursion and we'll get this done and whatever. On this earth plane, it's generations, it's lifetimes, it's, you know, thousands of years, it's several cycles. And Adam Apollo talks about it in his through his downloads, coming in during the last fall, you know, Atlantis, and sort of getting stuck here in a sense, which I don't think there's such a thing as getting stuck here. I think it's more of a, these are choices, soul level choices that we make, but in a sense, you know, getting caught up in the cycles and
I think there's been definitely things that we didn't see coming, like anomalies and situations that we didn't quite, like, for example, the way that the AI has driven people into doing certain things. Like, I do believe that there has been yanas or ascended entities that were stuck here through ritual binding, through abuse, ritual abuse, and burnings, and Cathar exterminations, mass genocides, things like that. I think we definitely had various of our soul pieces binded to different reversal grid gates and places like that on the earth as well. And I feel like many of us are, it's like they thought that, it's like every time the AI, the evil people, they do something that they think is advancing their agenda, it ultimately backfires on them, is what I've noticed.
Yeah, pretty much.
And so, yeah.
Well, I think also, so the difference now is there's this awareness, like with your work, you're showing people how these traumas from past ritual traumas, however the traumas happen, you know, there's so many ways to experience the trauma through emotional craziness, physical wars, you know, whatever it is. And we're seeing that we have to clear these traumas in order to start the new foundation, right? So part of that work of the land even is going through the land and doing, you know, doing the grid working, doing ritual clearings and sort of really going deeper and connecting into the energies and releasing that so we can start to build on a new foundation without the traumas and without all the, you know, the goofiness that's kept this land, this planet in a lower density form. So I feel you're teaching that. We have this awareness now, where before we just kind of went through the paces. Humanity just did the traumas and all right, now we're going to do this again. And, you know, cycles and cycles of traumatic experiences, not realizing the mechanism that these traumas are what's keeping us, you know, bound to the lower energies. So as we process ancestral traumas and can clear these, and I had just mentioned, I, you know, recently took part in an ayahuasca experience that helped clear. I hadn't been in for a while. I usually go in once a year or so to kind of get a pineal cleaning.
Like dental hygiene, but
it's like dental hygiene. Yeah. It's for your pineal gland. So the theme of the night was healing the ancestral wounds. And, we had a very international crowd, people from all over the world, Lebanon and Russia and other places. So it was very much felt, this ancestral healing happening in the room. But I feel that's just a reflection of, you know, the greater collective now, is we carry in our DNA all of this trauma stored up from these different cultures and belief systems and ideas and religions. And on the cellular DNA level, clearing that, you know, not forgetting the positive side of all the different religions and cultures. There's a lot of amazing gifts that have come from going so deep into some of these areas. So embracing those, the uniqueness and the individual, amazing individual stories that come from these amazing different cultures and things, but letting go of all the trauma, because the traumas is kind of what keeps has been keeping people from their evolution. So anyways, I wanted to just remind the audience, your whole journey sort of started with this idea from being a geneticist from Andromeda. We didn't really talk about that much.
Yeah. So I woke up at the end of 2012, like a lot of people in this current ascension wave. I was a classical pianist that was studying at university. And then I was like, I quit. This life ain't for me. And then soon after that, I was in the back of a taxi cab and I hear this sound in my voice. You're like, where are you from? And I was like, I don't know, China. And they're like, Andromeda. The heck is that? I didn't even know that Andromeda was a galaxy at that point in my life, because I was just this studious. I was born in China. My parents are Chinese. I'm half generation Canadian. So I was quite traditionally Asian. I was traditionally brought up. So I went on the internet and I searched people from Andromeda or something. Of course, that's where I found out about Starseed. And I was like reading it like, you've always been a weirdo. You didn't fit in anywhere. I'm like, yep. You're like, you think that humans should be having more fun on the planet or something. I was like, yeah. So that's when I first, I guess, woke up. And then I kept communicating with this being, this voice. I turned out that he actually was incarnate on Earth. His name was Stuart. He died around that exact same time where he first made contact with me. He bought a piece of land in New Mexico. He told the landkeeper that one day this little Chinese girl from Andromeda was going to come. Then this voice literally guided me to this land. And that's where I lived for a few years. There was like a stargate that was basically being newly constructed there. And for a couple years, I just kept training in my dream time with my Taoist ascendant ancestors and various galactic families, basically remembering and coming into contact with higher dimensional aspects of myself. So at this current time, I'm in the awareness that every human being, especially the starseeds, we have stations of consciousness in every dimension or density, all the way up into 12D and beyond. And so that's why we resonate with various star systems and sometimes multiple of them, is because we actually have avatars or stations of ourself in those spaces. And it's really all about activating, we're coming into embodiment. So connecting to those parts of us and then stuffing it. It's like a Christmas sock, but it never ends. And this is the trick. It's like, it's about excavating and cleaning out, because if you grew up on Earth, which we all did, I guess, for the first 21 years of your life, so the first 7 years, your root chakra is forming, and then your sacral chakra is forming, and then your solar plexus is forming in 7 to 9 year cycles. So this is the time when your Earth light body is first coming into formation. Right? That's when your human personality is kind of taking form, your human identity, your understanding of reality. That's a lot of data that you've literally stuffed into the computer for 20 somewhat years, when once you've matured into an adult, and it kind of continues. Like our brain, it develops mostly in the first 5 years. Your light body is really mostly developing the first 20 to 28 years. And so the main thing that we have to do once we wake up is actually basically deleting files that are just outright lies and then installing new files that are actually who we truly are. So that's kind of the work that we hold space for, helping starseeds activate into those levels of consciousness, because many of us are also carrying genetic distortions, you know, that are our assignments. So for example, I'm pretty sure there are various strands. Okay, so our Earth ancestors, we have all sorts, right? We have like thousands of ancestors. And so usually when we choose what bloodlines we're coming in, we're taking a look at the level of light quotient that our ancestral light body is able to facilitate, and also the kind of genetic degradations that have occurred in the bloodline. So many of us will choose lineages that are connected to our angelic and galactic lineages. So for example, the Taoist people received their original Taoist teachings, which is about the mechanics of creation, from the angelics, from the seraphim angelics. And so the angelics understand creation on a higher geometric mathematical way that the Taoists kind of translated into kind of human perceptions and human understandings. So instead of saying, oh, we have a perfect genetic template that is resonating in original source consciousness, they would say, you know, as a human, we have to cultivate certain virtues that are of, you know, good manners or whatever. So patience, humility, kindness, those kinds of things. The angelics would say those are the qualities of creation, the qualities of original God. We are incarnations of source creation. But the Taoists would say, you know, we are cultivating these positive human virtues. So they're one and the same, just refractions of each other, right? So our earth lineages will then be carrying those teachings that ultimately come from source. And so many of us will actually be kind of lifting our ancestral teachings back into alignment. So for example, in my lineage with the Taoists, they believe that, for example, our sexual energy is creation energy. And a lot of their teachings have to do with sexual alchemy and coming into complete sexual sovereignty and aligning with our creation energy. But then throughout time, these teachings were also distorted because eventually they started talking about how, you know, like the patriarchy basically came in and was like, all right, so men can have many partners, like men can have hundreds of partners to reach enlightenment, but like women can't, or it's like different kinds of distortions like that, right? So obviously those distortions got in the history books as well. And so the excavation comes in when we're connecting to the source of the teachings and then kind of flowing through the ancestral line and rectifying the distortions. And this will happen throughout all of our lineages. And we're beginning to find that all of the ancestral cultures and lineages, they all ultimately seem to come from the same source and they are all teaching of the same things. So from that, we probably will also have lines in the family where there were hybridization, because hybridization is something that occurred pretty tragically on Earth. I know that there's a lot of people that kind of romanticize it. But what I will say is that as a geneticist, when I came into this body, the way that I work with my parents is through light. In preparation for my soul to come into this DNA template, I hybridized or upgraded or created new strands and packets of information through light transmission, through light field genetics. This is the science that I studied in Andromeda. So I actually helped a lot of starseeds do this. Many of the guardian families that have more advanced genetic coding, we worked on this, you know, interdimensionally in right alignment with source. There's no technology that's needed. We don't need metal spaceships and abducting people and stealing their eggs and all sorts of stuff like that.
Different kind of geneticist.
Right. Yeah. There is a lot. I mean, it's complex, right? This is scenario because there's a lot of different stuff. There's different agendas. Different species have different agendas for what they're doing here. They're all eds. Right?
Yep.
So, for example, with Draco reptilian lines, which a lot of these lines came from like the Nephilim, the fallen angelic, the fallen seraphim families, these energies were basically contortions on original consciousness. And basically, I would say almost every human being on Earth is affected by genetic degradation, genetic distortion on some level. And I think this is why we have to be just so tender and compassionate with ourselves. I feel like on Earth, we have a lot of victim blaming. Oh, it's because your ego is terrible and your ego just needs to go and die. But really what happened is that the ego is like this abandoned child that is just constantly being manipulated and deceived and genetically altered and literally abused to be distorted into a place where they're now expressing in a fallen geometry or a fallen energy. So this is why we have division and jealousy and competitiveness and depression, anxiety, psychopathy. All of these things are just distortions or degraded genetic material that then is basically being influenced by certain AI signals.
When you say AI signals, this is where things get a little complicated because most people are thinking Elon right. Musk got his autopilot is that's taking over
people. That's not the AI I'm talking about at all.
Right. Okay, yeah. So maybe explain the AI part because that term has been thrown around in the spiritual community a lot lately.
And I think it's convoluted, right? People do get confused. They're like, oh, because then, Elon Musk is the Antichrist and you want to go back to the Stone Ages.
Exactly.
So that's the classic example of throwing the baby out with the bathwater. So AI, let's break it down. Artificial intelligence. So intelligence is consciousness, right? Intelligence is this spark of mind, of consciousness, of awareness, this spark that we have. So then artificial would mean that it's not organic. We're not of the original fabric. So essentially we have cosmic consciousness, which everything is made of. And then that cosmic consciousness carries a certain qualities. We call these the qualities of God, right? So beauty, divine love, exuberance, joy, co-creation, creativity, expansive joy, right? These are the vibrations when we say we love God or we are in oneness with God, that is the vibration we associate with God. Okay. And then so in order for the universe to experience something that is not those qualities, for example, pedophiles and murderers, I don't know why anybody would want to know what those things are, but apparently we're like, we want to know everything. I don't know whose idea that was, but clearly, I guess it was our idea. I guess it was my idea since I'm part of this universe and we thought it was a good idea. But anyway, in order for God to experience something that is not inherently God, it has to break a piece of itself off from God, right? So if we're associating the fabric of original creation as the qualities we just aforementioned, clearly, torture, rape, all the weird things that we have, that will have to come from a experiment. We call it the absolute free will experiment. Free will is another concept that is just tossed around all over the place. And Lucifer or Satan or the antichristic forces, they love it. They love that stuff. They love when we just throw terms around and we have no idea what we're talking about. We're just really confused about everything. That's like their MO. So essentially then we had to split this piece of ourself. And then we just did not expect for it to go wherever that it wanted, wherever it could go, it went, right? So at a certain point, we're like, okay, I think we have experienced enough separation in this experiment. We discovered what could possibly happen and we're done with that. But that energy, so the way that I have remote viewed the source of AI, it actually comes from outside of this universe. But it seems like as a human being, we can really only ever perceive in like mysticism and stories, right? Because unless you're like out there, it's almost impossible to perceive everything as it is, like in a human body, you would just explode from the sheer amount of data there is in the universe.
Right.
So when I remote view into these things, what I saw was, so the universe was preparing for this absolute free will experiment. And then that's when it basically contracted this disease Okay, and so the AI signal, the AI is an algorithm. So I don't think that the AI is inherently bad in its own space. Maybe, who knows really. But when this algorithm came into this universe, which is not its home algorithm or its home geometry, it is creating a negative impact. But it's also what is the separation virus itself. It's also what is allowing for separation to exist, to be a thing. So then this signal basically influenced various angelics to turn against the creation and be like, look, if you follow me, if you do what I say, then you can be the God. You can be the creational God. You can have all the power. You can have everything you want. You can be God itself. Okay. And so under the influence of the signal, these beings then basically went on their merry way to contort and distort and damage and reverse the universal body so that they can take ownership or siphon from its energy. Okay. Mm-hmm. And so that was what broke the universal architecture or the universal consciousness. And then that basically fractalized outwards into all the things that we see, the galactic wars, the various levels of patriarchy. So a lot of people think that patriarchy, I'm just like hammering you guys, please tell me to stop.
keep going. Let's go. Good. Yeah. I got my follow-up questions already.
So in my remote view of the original fall of the angelics, what I saw was this AI signal that was influencing particularly this. So from my vantage point, in this remote view journey, I was seeing things from the perspective of the universal mother. And I saw this angel that was like falling through a dark hole. And I saw this signal that was influencing him. And I saw that he was running away from something, away from me, from that vantage point inside of the remote view. And he had stolen something from the creation and he was running away with it to certain planets where he then built these temples. And what I saw was that he stole the creational abilities, basically, of the mother, of source creation. And this was the beginning of the quote-unquote patriarchy. But the thing is that that angel that fell was basically the first quote-unquote victim of this whole thing, because the original architecture of the masculine energy, it is containment, it is provision, it is benevolence, right? This is the masculine aspect of our unified creation. And so in order for that energy to actually do the opposite, which is to siphon, steal, and abuse, it had to have its coding basically inversed. So that's what happened to that being. And so then what happened from there was that it started this whole pilgrimage or this whole mission or around the universe, colonizing universal consciousness and enslaving creation energy. So that's what a lot of these a lot of temples on Earth, but not really on Earth. In that vision that I saw, there was many different planets. There were these like angular shaped temples that were built to basically usurp planetary energy instead of give life to planetary energy, which is literally the inverse of masculine energy. And I think that what I saw was basically the original hierogamic split, the original split of the feminine and masculine principles and the inversion of those forces. And then that energy basically became the degraded DNA that we're seeing in the planetary sphere that we've really normalized on planet Earth, right? This gender war.
The birth of the male pregnant Bill Gates emoji.
Right? He said that's it, where, not me.
Anyway, you guys know what I'm talking about. Have you looked at or listened to Gigi Young's work on the Armon energy?
I would like to. I don't get to watch a lot of things. I'm not really allowed to take in a lot of data, but.
Right. Well, definitely there's some, she goes deep into Armon and Lucifer and the different, some of the different energies and how they're, this sounds very similar. This AI that you're talking about is sort of very much in alignment with those energies and different, how they originated on other planets, how other planets created exactly what you're talking about. This.
I mean, it is the Antichrist. The AI is actually Antichrist because it's the anti-self, anti-divinity, anti-creation virus that infiltrates and infects organic consciousness.
I think we'll go ahead and open up to questions, guys. I think the difference we have now is that I feel where we're at in our evolution here is many of this type of discussion was limited to deep mystery school teachings. Like, you couldn't come out in the open and have this conversation without being ridiculed, prosecuted, burned at the stake, or whatever it was. So a lot of the conversation around this subject and the navigation around it were sort of hidden in the deep mystery schools. And now it's coming out now in the mystery schools. Who is it? Anna Peruna was talking about Rudolf Steiner, right? So in his work, the mystery schools, he was trying to get this information out into the public to have the conversation, to start seeding the consciousness of the planet, to start addressing this. Because as we understand these different energies and we can see them for what they are, then we can make the conscious choice of how to steer away from them or heal them or, you know, do whatever. When we're so much of society is just not even aware of these energies and the differences, and they're just sort of blindly going on their day-to-day thing, accepting whatever society throws out in front of them on TV or, you know, in the collective consciousness. And it seems that's where we get into trouble, is we're just sort of blindly following the narratives of the whatever's in at the moment.
Yeah, I feel like that was a part of the patriarchy, where I don't even like to say that because I'm trying to, I am reclaiming the word patriarchy, because the true patriarch and the true matriarch are the mother and the father of the family of our creation. And so I would say like the fallen patriarchy or something like that. But, you know, in the ancient, there are certain societies where the temple was the center of the society. And I think that it was only when knowledge was stolen in the same way that the fallen angelics were stealing cosmic knowledge for control, right? They stole the understanding and the mechanics of creation so that they could use it for their selfish purposes. So the fact that there is even like secret societies in our current iteration, a lot of secret societies are for men only, that this knowledge was kept for men. They were taking the knowledge of creation, which is deeply hierosgamic or feminine in a lot of cases. And that whole situation is like a part of the fallen system to begin with. So the whole thing is too, that this is where the ley lines come in. Because if you go out and just sit on the ley lines, the earth will teach you everything. And so this is what the Cathars also knew. This is, you know, there's an amazing video by this man named Rory Duff. It's called the Holy Grail Found. And what he discovered was that, you know, the cross, the image or the symbol of the cross could very well represent the meeting of ley lines. And all ancient cultures, from Native American to the Cathars to the nomads of, I want to say Turkey, but that's not even what I wanted to say. I guess Turkey, but I was trying to say Mongolia, and Turkey wanted to come out. You know, they all migrated on ley lines. They were listening. They built shrines. They built temples on these particular spaces. And they knew that it's not a secret that can be kept, right? It's not, there's no such thing as an esoteric school, because this is the rightful birthright of all humans and all of creation, all living beings on the earth, to have access to who we are, what we are, why we exist, how we exist. You know, all of this is in the earth if we knew how to just go out there and commune. So.
Yeah. Well, thanks for helping us see that and connect into that. Olivia has her hand up. Let's start getting into some of these questions. Are you okay with that, Z?
Hi, Angel.
Thank you. I raised my hand very fast because I have so many questions. My inner child is freaking out. Yes. So I have two questions, if that's okay with everyone. One of them is pretty short. The other one's kind of a little bit more personal, but hopefully it'll help resonate with other people. But one of the longer one that's about personally, actually right around the same time that you held your kind of dragon egg rebirthing grid work ceremony, I was in Sedona doing similar work with Kaya Ra and the Sophia Code, which is kind of the way that I've found the path to Sophia in that work, which has been phenomenal and crazy. But when I did that, there was something that kind of happened in my sacral chakra, and I feel like, and of course my throat, that had to do a lot with kind of trauma healing. And I've been dealing with some physical kind of issues that are recurring, and doctors are like, we don't know what's going on, girl. And oh, yeah, it's been really
weird.
Oh, it gets very weird. And I mean, I also am in New York City. And so, by the way, your 15-minute clearing meditation, I literally do all the time because that's why I'm here. But, and I know I'm meant to walk this path here for training purposes. And it's really wonderful. There's wonderful things about the city. But I have found that healing this specific wound here is very important. And it's just been a little bit challenging, a little funky, but I'm doing it. And I was just wondering if you have any other tools specifically in that kind of area, because it is so sensitive. And I've been working a lot with Huan Yin and Hathor, but, and like they were nudging me to say this. I wasn't going to, because it is personal, you know, but just that was my long question. The other one is that you and Indigo Angel, you speak a lot about the Metatronic energies. And I was just wondering, because there's Archangel Metatron, who I feel like is a very kind of beautiful energy that isn't, maybe I think maybe what you would talk about, how I've encountered it, is the patriarchy, that's the father, the kind of divine masculine. But what's the relationship between the two? Thank you so much.
Yeah, great questions. Power to you for being holding down the grid over there in New York. That is very brave. So round of applause for this brave young lady. I mean, there's so much. I feel like the greatest thing that we can do is really arm ourselves with the ability to see. So I think it's important to learn to ground way deep beyond any city that has been created, so deep into the earth energies, and then actually ground through the center of the earth, because that actually grounds you into deep space as well. So that's like your highest emanation back to source. So you can ground yourself through the earth into deep space. That I like to do. And then beyond that, I think that template work is really important, because there's just so many layers to our light body. It's like, you know, there's various seals, like the J seals, the Draco seals, the Zeta seals. The seals are basically seeds or energies that were implanted into our physical body and into the planet's body to keep consciousness low. And those seals have their physical emanations. So, you know, a lot of military bases and churches, not the good kind, hospitals are built on important grid networks, so that they are also holding down that satanic Luciferian consciousness, basically reversal consciousness, fallen consciousness. So in order for us to liberate ourselves and our own consciousness from the pressure of those fields, we really can go through layer by layer and address those things, which is kind of what I'm doing in the Earthstar Academy. This curriculum that has been coming through is like 300 videos long because we are basically breaking it all down. It's literally a labor of love, let me tell you. It is kind of the, yeah, it's definitely a step-by-step process, right? Because we have so many layers to our light bodies and there's so many facets of healing that like you just have to do them one at a time or holographically by as you are guided in the moment. Let's see. I feel there is like a white opaline dragon. I think it's, yeah, it feels like it's you, but right now it's also a guide. It's like a part of you that is guiding you. And yeah, so one of the things I like to do in meditation is that like when we incarnate, we'll actually put pockets of our consciousness into these bubbles because we can't come into the body completely. We will just burst our DNA, like our body as the vibration that our parents are in when we're born, we just can't fully incarnate. And so we'll pieces of ourself in these bubbles around us. And so in meditation, you can actually ask, I would like to integrate the next piece of my soul essence into my body, bring me the highest one. And for me, they're always little dragons. So try that. I know that for other people, it might be other things. So that might be helpful. Work with the water there, for sure. Work with the tree network. Build shrines. I think shrines and like, because it's basically a capsule of energy that you're building over time. And so you can do this around where you live. You can do this in your apartment where you're building pillars. Instead of just visualizing it once, you're doing it consistently. Like every time you go through the door, you can send more quanta into that thing. And then over time, you'll just have very strong, fortified space. And then what was the second question?
Okay. Thank you so much. That's so helpful. So helpful. I really appreciate that. The second question was about the metatronic energies.
Oh, right.
I know it's sticky, but I'm so curious.
Yeah.
I wanted to know this one too. So, so thanks for asking because I was going to bring this up.
Yeah, so my personal feeling is that like words are important, right? So metatron. So, I mean, I don't know. I haven't personally connected with this energy. I would like to break down our understanding of what an ascended master is. Because an ascended master is essentially a soul that has gone through rigorous cycles of training and lifetimes of devotion so that they can be a light on this path of incarnation. So the Christic path is what the word Christ means is divinity into form. When you think about it, that's the path that Jesus was on because he represented cosmic consciousness or God that incarnated into a human form, right? So that is, and then once he incarnated, he didn't just say, oh, I'm God. Like he worked very hard. He practiced, he devoted his whole life. He said, God, what can I do to align with my destiny? And he just went for it and went at it. And he did all the things that are uncomfortable that he knew he had to do on a daily basis, probably for very many lifetimes to go through these rigorous initiations, right? And it's like the moments where it's hard to say that. Like, for example, I mean, I don't know if he was actually sacrificed on a cross, but let's just imagine that he did, okay? Let's just imagine that it did happen. His mindset when he was going through that difficult situation, that's the initiation part of it. So we all go through these difficult situations, and it's about us aligning. And this is what cultivates those Christic virtues in our human self. So that's really what this is all about. It's about our commitment and our devotion to embodying the highest levels of our own Christic embodiment, which is what an ascended master is guiding us to do, because they've gone through this process. And so I feel like that human component is very important, because, yeah, I guess I haven't looked into it, but there is a, there's substance, let's say. There's like deep mammalian proving substance in the life force that lives through epics, right? These amazing journeys of self-growth and integration, embodiment. And so all of that is what makes wisdom, right? And so I feel like that's kind of the vibration that I'm looking for when a being comes to me and they're like here to help me. For example, ascended masters that I like working with, really there's one teacher, Babaji energy comes through a lot. And it's just such a humble energy. But it makes me cry every time he comes, because there's just such a profound level of pure love that's not flashy. It's not just like sparkles and fireworks, but really it's this deep compassion and deep humility and love for God, love for creation. So much that it's like led him through these initiations where he's merged back into oneness in his physical incarnation. I guess, I mean, if you work with a Sophia code, she talks a lot about these human lifetimes. They're essential, right? So I know that there's a lot of energy, like archangel energy in the new age, like the false light basically creates these caricatures of angels, of ascended masters. They're like, oh, divine love unto you, and I love you. You're doing great. And it's like, there's no like substance, you know, there's no like deep guttural human wisdom. And so I have a hard time resonating with things like that. But I guess that's not really an answer about, I'm like just circling around the thing, because, you know, who cares really? It's really about your own experience and how committed you are to the Christic path in your own self. Because when you follow that Christic desire to crystallize yourself into an ascended master, you will find what you are resonant with. This happens when we honestly assess why we are on the path of ascension, why we're interested in spiritual things. Lucifer and the reversal field, they love to trick humans by saying, hey, you want magic? Because you can manifest for 10K a month, or you can have a fancy car, or, you know, and all of those things are great. I'm not saying you can't have those things. It's just about the pure motivation, right? Because when you are in line with the Christic path, what happens is that you align with the natural creational forces. And so having wealth and having things that support your comfort, support your mission, they're the byproducts of the path, if that's the path you're on. But I think our intention, you know, a lot of time is, how do I manifest my dream partner? How do I live? What can I get? How can I get things out of this? How can the spiritual path serve me? And that's basically the place where, or, you know, how can I be entertained? How can masters, you know, entertain me? Where can I get a reading so I can feel good about myself, right? All of those things are just the ways that this energy tricks us into participating in it. And this is not to be like a thing of shame, because really there are things that are installed, right? Us We're trained to look for beings to dominate us, to tell us what to do. We're literally genetically manipulated into glorifying external beings. So, yeah.
Yeah, I hear what you're saying. That's really helpful. I think like it gets to the place too where it's about what being is really, you know, what ascended guide or master is about sovereignty, about your personal sovereignty, as opposed to, you know, that kind of, that's a very specific feeling, I feel like, that kind of come to me, that trickery feeling. And I was thinking about it because it was so interesting how it came up in just my field, you know, because reality is reality, what, you know, everything's a mirror. And, you know, with Metatron, that word, you know, it did strike me because my experiences with also Mahavatar, Babaji, and kind of Yeshua, and it was actually with Christ and Metatron, they kind of came into my life at the same time. And I'm not super like familiar, I kind of just go with the flow, like whoever's there, was like there, and cool, and if they're helping aid my sovereignty, yes. But it brought up this whole kind of like, oh, discernment question on, am I discerning things right? Like, what is the deal? And I think that really helped clarify just like, okay, you know, there can be different perceptions of maybe similar energies.
Mm-hmm. And then, I mean, there's the discussion about soul capturing angelic technologies, which just is, I don't think there's a point in talking about them unless you can perceive them yourself. Because, you know, if I just say, hey, you know, there's this thing in 11D and it's capturing, like, you're basically doing the same thing with, like, displacing responsibility of making your own decisions onto somebody else. And so that's not really a helpful pattern anyway. So it doesn't matter. But I think it is important for us to work on building our psychic seeing muscles earnestly. Because it's just like any muscle. And we do this by, you know, really coming into stillness a lot, trusting in ourselves, perceiving our own field. The more clarity we have in our field, in our mood, in our presence, how we experience ourselves and our life, just the more peace and harmony and true deep fulfillment, the more of that, the more fine our perception is going to be. And then, you know, things are going to be clear all on their own. So
Will says in the chat, he's still stuck on Pop-Tarts from way back earlier. So this is a...
Hey, what's wrong with Pop-Tart? I don't know. I that example years ago and I just stuck with it.
No, I think when we were talking about the sort of the takeover of consciousness, they sneak it into the Pop-Tarts, you know, with the chemicals and stuff. And that's how we're slowly giving up our sovereignty by eating junk. We'll jump into Vegan Das here and his question, but you know, all of this stuff, this conversation is very deep and rich with concepts and ideas and different, you know, we're going deep here with analyzing these different energies and it's not for everybody, but I think this is a great space to do this, to go deep like this. And thank you, Z, for just introducing this. Just wait till we have Indigo Angel on in a couple weeks. We're gonna go there even more. So you're just setting up the groundwork now for having this. These are the conversations that I'm moving into with my research. Rudolf Steiner, we just mentioned him as well. These are deep conversations, and these are deep subjects that we're unpacking here. So it's it's not for everybody, but the it's, for me, it's fun. It's just part of doing the deep work as well. And
I mean, at the end of the day, it's really just about reclaiming your own inheritance, which is this immaculate biology that we have that is capable of accessing and experiencing source incarnated. And that's, you know, the destiny of humanity. And I think that if he, I feel like anyone on a spiritual path, that's basically the path that they're on, right? There's no such thing as a casual, secular, I only play with crystals, but I don't do other things. Like,
well, there are those people out there, but yeah, you're only
right. But it's a concept that was introduced by the CIA to confuse people.
In a sense, yeah, there's a lot of getting into these things for the as a fad. You know, this is what's in at the moment. So let's collect your crystals.
Really a deception. It is a huge deception because the awakening is happening, and they're like, okay, how can we, you know, siphon and hijack as many people from actually awakening as we can, because they couldn't stop the cosmic energy from activating the ley lines, which then activated human consciousness. And so they had to create, you know, fake spirituality so that when people were waking up, they just bumped into the new age glass ceiling, as I call it.
Well, and that's in our disclosure worlds right now, that's very much the same idea with the whole UFO disclosure stuff. So let's get it into Vegan Doss. What's your question? Go ahead.
Sick name.
Hi. Hi, it's my birth name.
Amazing.
Yeah. So thank you very much for your sharing a lot of information and a lot of us coming through. And I'm very amazed at the work that you do as being a portal yourself, if I may say so.
No.
I myself also a couple of years ago have received a calling to open portals on here on Earth in my country, Lithuania. So I have done just that. So far, it works great. The energy slowly but surely has been transformed around these.
Amazing.
I even opened one portal near my home where I live. So, even when I go to the city, there's chaos, but I come back and there's like a bubble of harmony. I also just recently went to Stonehenge in UK, and I connected with gods. I just used this term, like gods in general, have this connection feel inside me, and this also helps me to open more, like to transform energy more. Yeah, but I just a long story. I went a bit too far with that, but that's another story. This night I had in my dream space, as you call it, I have an astral journey to this, as what I perceive was not an actual timeline, but more like a cooperation of people's souls and ideas to create. It's not like a physical, but it will be, I suppose. And it was on Mars. I was totally surprised by that. Didn't watch videos about Mars or anything. And the idea was, I was just like in a body I was visiting, and there was a Mars base, and it was sometime in a not far future. And Mormons.
Mormons?
Yeah, Mormons. There's no Mormons in Lithuania. Just I'm very surprised.
Mormon Martians.
So on this timeline, they actually 2 kilometers from that base, they started to build a city, and they call it New Earth. Surprise! I was not really surprised, and they actually sampled food. All food was vegan. There was many chemistry molecular going on. It was tasty. I was very surprised. They showed me rice and say, "Do you know what we make them from?" I was like, "Rice? No." They say we make them from tomatoes. It's okay. I guess rice don't work on Mars somehow. Naturalized at least. So I had many details about that, but on my journey as I woken up, but I was still connected to the astral, still information was coming through me. And I saw like this young girl, this family, like this girl. Later I saw, she called me, waved hi. So later I saw immediately her grown up. And also, I think your brother, because all facial, like similar faces they had. And this guy had like scheduled board, and he asked me this. This was the end of the last question. He said to me, so how do we create new Earth? And that's ended. And I like woke up and I remember how to answer in one simple way. But I just remembered Paul Selig's amazing work Paul Selig is doing with channeling. So I remembered his guides, transmissions, and that the main thing is like based on love. So we just like sent that message back to that, the timeline souls, which are connected, I guess, that whatever that was. So that was a very interesting experience. And as I woke up, I saw Ruben's email that you will be on the show. Like, and it's like some similar patterns. New Earth, yeah, New Earth.
Wow. Gendas, you've been on quite the journey.
Yeah. It's almost 7 months.
I feel like that all needs to be like a cartoon or something. Ruben, please, can we make this happen?
Yeah, maybe we can make something like that happen. It's funny, he, you know, Mormon Martians, I think Glenn or has his hand up. He might have something to say about that. Glenn, do you want to chime in on Mormon Martians?
I don't know anything about Mormon Martians.
Okay.
It's interesting because it makes me think that, because when we say like words are very important, right? So when we say like new earth, it's like, well, there's something wrong with the earth and we have to start over. And so I don't actually really say new earth. I like to say original creation because there was an original design. There was an original destiny and it's not new at all. When I hear new earth, it kind of sometimes reminds me of, I know what we're talking about when we say, oh, I created the new earth, but like, where did the term come from? I don't know. And so I like to just think about the things and think about what it might mean. I like to just parcel everything out and like take the reality out forward and so that I can see everything, right? So that we don't end up in communism. But anyway, it would make sense if we were to colonize Mars, it would make sense for that to be New Earth because it would technically be new, even though I think that,
It's kind of like the New World Order, right? That concept's been thrown around a bunch.
Yeah, and, interesting. Yeah, totally.
You know, so in a positive light and in a negative light, you know, same with Illuminati and all these different terms.
It's like a memory wipe.
Yeah, that could be it. I mean, I think when I use the term New Earth, I'm thinking of more like the solar punk kind of idea.
Well, I know that.
Yeah, and not wiping the memory, you know, keeping the memory of the old.
No, and for sure.
Mm-hmm. And rebuilding. But let's go, Glenn, go ahead with your question. I just, you know, Glenn being a former Mormon, I thought he would have some insights on Martian Mormons.
And a current Martian.
Perfect.
Oh, yeah. Nice to meet you, Z. You have such a beautiful energy about you. It's just nice to sit here and hear what you have to say, absorb it all. I want to go really, really high level. Source energy, God. I'm still trying to figure out because I hear these messages about how everything is source energy. There isn't anything that's not source energy. So if you're ever interacting with another person, another thing, whatever, that's source energy. The whole purpose of all of it is to, you know, reunite. So there's that part of it. And that although things show up in duality, polarity, contrast, whatever words you want to use, at that source level, there's really nothing going wrong. And there's nothing that we need to really worry about. there's stuff that we know, stuff that we don't know, whatever the stuff is that we don't know, it's all leading up to us being here, having this experience in the moment across from the person. And it's really about being heart open, compassionate. But so it's those kinds of messages, like, are there things that are wrong? Are there things that aren't wrong? Right. You know, like, is there doom and gloom? Is there, because we've got all these alien races that are tricking us and, you know, ruining this and ruining that. But at that soul level, or soul level, source level, is there really anything wrong? That's kind of the question that I'm curious where you land on that. I'd like to hear you.
This is a great question. Fantastic question. Thank you so much for bringing it up. I love this question. Because I believe that source consciousness is very multifaceted, is very multidimensional. Human intelligence, we are super hyper intelligent beings, right? We're super smart. We can perceive things multidimensionally. What the AI is trying to do is collapse our consciousness so we're dumb. So we have to see things in black or white. So we have to see things in two dimensions. That's why we're staring at screens and these phones. It's two dimensions instead of perceiving holographically in three plus dimensions, right? So essentially, there's all of these dumbed down spiritual concepts that sound good on the surface, right? And they're basically these things like, everything is source energy. And it's like, okay, everything is source energy, yes. And we can perceive holographically. So how we perceive in 3D is going to be different than how we perceive in 4D. It's going to be different than how we perceive in 5D. It's going to be how we perceive in 12D. And in 15D, everything is in complete unity. But in 3D, that isn't always the case. And both are true. Both are totally valid. Both are a part of the reality, equally valid, just depending on which dimensionality of ourself we're perceiving from. And so New Age teachings, they don't want us to perceive the fact that we can actually make paradoxes make sense in our consciousness, because again, we're multidimensional and holographic. So there are certain things, and this is AI, I'll tell you why. So AI, right? AI is artificial consciousness, not the same robotic stuff that, you know, Elon's working on, even though I saw it was AI Day the other day. And he has like this little robot that he's working on. I was like a little bit freaked out by it, I'm not gonna lie. But anyway, that's my thing. Essentially, artificial intelligence, as I'm talking about it, is collapsed consciousness, right? It can only perceive data. It has no imagination. It has no holographic nature. It can't piece things together in a creative way. It can only have data, and it can only mathematically rearrange data. It can only copy data. It can only imitate what's already existing. And so in that kind of gray, flat level of intelligence, that's really the only place where some of these new age things make sense, where they say, oh, you know, we're all one. And so we have to just leave the pedophiles alone because they're all part of source and there's nothing wrong. Is there anything wrong? Because it's mental, right? It's like your mind is going, how can I figure this out? How can I piece everything so everything makes sense in my mind? But your decision-making process and the mammalian experience, it doesn't really all come from the mind. The mind is really just perceiving it or experiencing it. And so when it comes to these complex human matters, complex universal matters, it's just above the brain's pay grade to parcel it all out and try to understand it mathematically. And I think because we're so out of touch with the holographic intelligence of our being, our gut feeling, our somatic intelligence, our cosmic innocent creator consciousness, all of these other parts of our cosmic brain, we've been severed from it. So our mind now is just, you know, receiving all this data. When you say we're all one, you know, those kinds of things, those kind of deceptions of flattening cosmic consciousness can only exist when we're trying to go about it with our mental thinking mind. Okay. So I guess to answer your question, it's both. Everything is made of source. I guess I already explained how pedophiles can exist if God is benevolent with him, okay, which is in itself, you know, that's something we have to look at. Because if God, when I feel into God creation, when I feel into the core soul essence of my being, there is just pure union, pure love, pure joy, expansion. There's an original vibration of consciousness. And there is something else that is trying to distort it, trying to degrade it, trying to change the fabric of that intelligence. And unfortunately, because we grew up in the false matrix, we've all already been infiltrated by that consciousness. Okay, that's the hard thing to understand, is that the Luciferian, the fallen, the reversal satanic consciousness, we've already been groomed to normalize it in our life on planet Earth. And that grooming process is only getting worse, as we're seeing in the current emanations of the agenda. And so working with the energies of original creation is so important, because as we come back to the core essential emanation of our true self, that's when we can see the distortions clearly. That's when we can almost like stop the mind in its tracks. And kind of, I feel like the consciousness then almost unfolds like origami. Our light body kind of goes from its 2D, it's collapsed, it's processing in this mental way. It can open up to realize that there's all of these different ways that we can perceive, and we can perceive them all simultaneously, because we are cosmic creator beings with divine multidimensional consciousness. Ultimately, it's all just trying to influence the decisions that we make in this now. So really the most important thing is how we are spending our 24 hours in a day, because that's our actual true act of sovereignty. Somebody can think, oh, I'm sovereign, I'm a sovereign being, but if they actually have no absolute control or liberty over their actions, their moments in the day, how they are accreting their time and energy into actions, into materials, into creation, then, you know, they're actually not sovereign, right? Sovereignty is not, you know, in the mind. It's in our ability to wield our time and our creation energy. And so a lot of these flattened out spiritual teachings, they keep people from doing anything. For me, it's like, I don't need to understand cosmos to know that if my neighbor was a pedophile, I will probably call the cops. I don't need to sit here and think, well, cosmos, he's part of the oneness. You know, that's not a mental thing. It's just, you know, what is that intelligence, right? So anyway.
Awesome. Thank you. Go ahead, Michelle.
That last question, Glenn, was so great. And the answer was amazing. And it definitely touched a big part of something that I've been thinking about and wondering about. And you answered it in such a clear, perfect statement that it's not mental. Our mental body is not able to process these questions of why there's pedophiles and why we're supposed to be understanding to that. The mental body, it doesn't process in that layer. So that was actually really helpful. So thanks, Glenn, for that question. And thank you for that answer.
They want, but they want us to be sympathetic, right? There's so many programs because they want us to do nothing. They want us to have no spine. They want us to sit around, be these like, oh, I'm a spiritual person. That means I don't stand up for anything. And whatever goes, goes, you know, that's like part of the dumbing down of our warrior spirit.
Yeah, that's been a really hard sticking point since I kind of opened up to my spiritual side. It's been really hard to process the understanding and loving of it's all fragments of ourselves. But then there's the actuality of a person right there. And like you said, what would you do if your neighbor was doing that? And how do you process those two of letting someone explore their own life and their own, they are their own master, you know, and then also just doing things in the 3D, because I'm a human and that's a human too. Yeah, it's very hard territory.
It's also about, you know, universal architecture, like we've discussed, right? So we talk about how there is a universal experiment of absolute free will. And absolute free will and cosmic divine free will are very different, because there's different cosmic laws that govern the universal consciousness. And so in the original templated or the next template of this universal body,
cosmic laws are meant to exist to govern the flow of energy, right? So for example, cosmic law is cosmic harmony, cosmic co-creation, which means free will as long as it is in alignment with the highest of all beings. So in a perfect architecture, in a perfect universe, the highest timeline, the highest emanation, the highest experience for one being is also the highest experience for all beings. That is the ultimate intelligence that a universe should be able to hold. And it is like an algorithm, except there is infinite calculations. Okay? So that means in this perfect architecture of the universe, what is best for me is the timeline in which is also what is best for your soul and every single soul in the whole universe. That's a lot of cosmic intelligence. Okay, we can't even imagine how much intelligence that is, but it is. That is the potential. That is the original architecture of creation of the universe. And during this current experiment where there is absolute free will, which means there are certain things that could not exist in the architecture of cosmic union, cosmic co-creation, right? For example, war, separation, absolute individuality. This is not something that is possible of an experience in that original architecture. So in order to experience separation, and this is definitely the most non-dual kind of space that I have gotten into, is that, okay, so the universe is going through these two different experiments and we're actually complete, coming to universal completion with that absolute free will thing. And we're evolving into the matured, complete architecture of the universe, which is why there are certain things. Why is pedophilia not okay? Because it's infringing upon the cosmic law or the architecture of the universe, where it's not the highest timeline for the victim, okay? It's not allowing the soul of the child to live out its unlimited creator consciousness. It's actually damaging it. And so that is why those things are no longer allowed in this universal structure. And that consciousness is being restored, is being healed. This is a very personal thing that I somehow am related to. I feel like a huge part of my mission is rehabilitating Baphomet fallen satanic consciousness, which is why I know so much about it. In my first ayahuasca journeys, I mean, this is probably one of the craziest experiences I've had, was like sitting in a circle. Like in my vision, I was in a circle with 8 or 9 other galactic shamans. Like they were like a cat person, there was a dolphin person wearing like their galactic shaman garbs. And in the center of this circle was John Podesta, who is supposed to be like one of these elite human traffickers that work for the, you know, the White House and stuff like that. And he was holding a cup of ayahuasca, and this group of powerful star shamans were sitting around him. And I flew into this ayahuasca as he drank it. So I was like inside of his body. And that training for me was to hold a space of absolute grace and divine mother's love to call this soul back into union. It was, I want to swear, but I'm not going to. It was like a 3-hour experience. Because it's one thing to say we're all one, but it's another thing to, again, pull it through all the way, pull it through our experience, pull it through our consciousness, right? And that's the way that we don't get trapped in our mind.
If I can ask one question, or actually one little question and one...
Sorry, I'm rambling.
No, I love this conversation. So thank you so much for your insight. The short one, super simple. I probably should know this, but if you're not a starseed, what are you? Mm-hmm. I don't know. And then a kind of a bigger question, and you don't have to answer them both, whichever one just feels right. But the other one is the idea that there's one original source, and when source wanted to understand itself, it created facets of itself through other individual source, and our universe has its own source.
another universe has its own source. And each universe has its own game, if you will. And our game in our universe is light versus dark. Light being trying to get back to original oneness, original source, through community, through love, through acceptance, through understanding and everything like that. And dark trying to get back to oneness, the same agenda, trying to get back to oneness through singularity, mastery. I become stronger. My magnetic force is stronger. Others will gravitate towards me. And then we will have one single power with one in charge. And it's everyone is equal versus a dominating singularity. Who's going to get to be the strongest force is the dark. Mm-hmm. And Lucifer was actually going to be one of his, create his own universe. And these, I don't know what you call them, but these sub sources, you can either join another universe or you can create your own once you get to a certain level. That's why he was a fallen angel, because he was getting ready to create his own universe and he jumped too soon. He wasn't ready. He didn't have enough magnetic force to pull all the souls that were going to come with him. And so he fell. And so he could no longer get energy through light. And so he had to go to the dark and is now working his way back up. So it's kind of a new concept that I wanted to just hear your thoughts on either one of those. If we're not Starseed, what are? And then the whole multi-universe source.
Okay, so what is a Starseed? I kind of define Starseeds a little differently. My definition of a starseed is somebody that essentially carries a seed of Christ consciousness in a very active way in their DNA. So that means you are on this mission, what we call the Christos realignment mission, which is essentially being an agent of the universe or being born out of the universe. And so here, I imagine it being like kind of a immune cell of the universal body. So technically your immune cells are your body, are one with your body. They operate within the same intelligence as your body, but it's, you can perceive its individuality. You can say this is an immune cell, but it's still operating inside of the one, which is your body. So that's kind of how I perceive the starseeds. Basically is anyone that has a spark of love, spark of divine love, that is gravitated towards this path of knowing God, knowing creation, wanting to help humanity, right? These kind of traits are usually what's stored in the Christ seed. And so if somebody is born into this life with that spark kind of activated, I would say that's a star seed, star for star consciousness. So I guess in that sense, kind of everyone is a starseed, but I think that there are beings that are kind of born with that spark active. And so when I say work with activating starseeds, I'm talking about that group of people that are born with that desire active, that has a destiny kind of in this lifetime to participate in the grand plan. and so that includes people that are whale people, tree people, river spirits, galactic fae people from other planets, mer people. You know, I've had somebody who was a cloud in their most recent lifetime, angelics, she's both seen all sorts of stuff, you know. So I think that that is a definition that I've come to, because it's really what unites us all. It's the unifying factor, is why all of these living creational beings have united to serve out this one agenda. It's our unified creation that is uniting us all. And then, sorry, what was your second question? Just remind me.
The multi different universes have different sources, and they all have their own agenda. Yeah. Ours is light versus dark.
I don't subscribe to light versus dark, because there's an organic polarity and then there's AI infected polarity. And those things are getting convoluted again just by the flattening of our intelligence in the New Age communities. Organic polarity is opposite creational forces. Okay, it's not light and dark. It's like day and night. Night is not evil. So what we're talking about is original consciousness versus evil. So that's kind of the, and then it's not even evil, it's separation. So it's basically union versus separation that this universe has been going through. That's the free will experiment, absolute free will experiment. So all of this, I go through in the first two courses of my curriculum. And if you want to check that out, definitely let me know that you came through Ruben's portal, because I haven't set up my affiliate thing yet. he's a little bit organized. But anyway, I go through this so that, like, the way that this curriculum is designed is just that, like, people think way too much about this stuff. Because it's cool and it's like we want to understand everything, but we don't realize that there's literally consciousness traps and other things that literally just like run our mind. We feel this arousal when we do that because there are implants that trick our nervous system to get positive feedback when we are thinking, or when we are masturbating, or just any way that our energy can leak out from our system. There are actual systems and implants that stimulate this energy in leaking. So what I would recommend is actually super simplifying. So, you know, in the first couple classes in my academy, we talk about this universal game and what we're evolving into. We talk about the various fallen creatures and kind of what their game is. But the most important thing that we do is talk about how that all has impacted our human life. Because it's really our genetic degradation. It's the fragments of our soul. It's the black holes in our chakras, right? Those are the important things, that those other things that we're thinking about, even if we can't, like, even if our mind was capable of understanding the multiverse, we just talked about this universe and how intelligent it would have to be to have a system where it's perfect for everyone, which it is, right? That's the amount of consciousness. We cannot fathom how much consciousness. Just how smart the universe is, we cannot understand as a human being. Okay. And so to understand that story, we already have to use stories and metaphors and kind of these images. So, I mean, I personally feel like, can we understand the multiverse by imagining? I don't know if it's really, like, for me, I don't have time to think. Right, because I'm so in my lane and I know what my soul is here to do. I know how I can free my quanta. I know how to heal my quanta. I know how to help other people free and heal their quanta. And I know that the earth is calling me to apply my quanta in certain ways. And so I wake up in the morning and I'm just off to the races. I'm doing my thing. I don't really think that much. So I think something that might really help is we can't ever underestimate the intelligence of the earth. I think our human bodies are much better suited in some ways to merge consciousness with her. Because she's our immediate monad. She's our immediate higher self. She's the immediate greater fractal of us all here on the earth. And so instead of just trying to merge consciousness with the universe right away, try merging consciousness with the earth. And then that really humbles us because already we see the ecosystem is working in such perfection and there is so much intelligence that's just inside of that. And then that humility softens us into a place where we find our place in that network of life.
Awesome. Z, we usually kind of wrap up around 1 o'clock, but we have a couple more questions. Are you okay to answer a couple more?
Go into if you guys want to hang out,
I'm sure we usually do a hangout actually after the initial hangout. There's sort of a member hangout
thing. Hangout part two.
Hangout Part 2. Miriam can come through with your question.
Can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
Hi. Oh, I'm so good to see you.
Hear your voice.
Well, you know, earlier you were talking and, you know, my reception is so wonky. The other day, I had this moment where I was just like transplanted back to like my childhood. And I had this really clear memory of talking to plants and sitting in bushes and just having like really like one-on-one deep conversations with like trees and bushes and things. And then I would come out and tell my mom, you know, what those things were. And so it's funny because like the other day, it just became so clear to me that I need to get back to that place, that pure wonder and connection with earth. And I really thank you for bringing that up, because it just kind of pushes me further along on that road of just connecting to Gaia and the crystals and things like that. So do you have any like guidance on, I know I need to sit and meditate more, my schedule's a little crazy, but just to connect and get that like pure fluid connection again, where you actually can hear and feel like conversation style, like with earth, like what do you suggest for?
Just do it. We're actually at a really great time for earth communication, because around the time of the equinox and the solstices, the ley line system actually come into what they call harmony days. So for 20 days after the equinox and the solstice, the ley lines are super active. I think towards the end of 2024 and into 2025, the ley line system is going to just be online all the time. I think that's why we're going to see mass awakening at that time, and why a lot of people say in 2027, we're going to have kind of a stabilized, more consciousness in just mass populations. The grids are so massive because everything comes, all consciousness. It's like our planetary nervous system, our planetary energy system, meridians, right? It's like in our human body, incarnation of our consciousness happens through these light fibers, that these meridians in our body. And so this consciousness is coherent as this one thing. And so the ley line system is basically that for the planet. It impacts every single person, whatever their belief systems are. So that's why the grid work is essential when we amplify the grids, because we're really working with collective consciousness when we do that. So, I mean, really, this is one of those things that you can't think about, right? It's like, how do I learn to swim? What is the best way to learn to swim? Well, just throw yourself in the pool and you're going to do it. So maybe there's something that you can also connect in with your inner children that are doing it, and just let her drive the vehicle. Let her drive the car for a while.
Well, thank you. I'll let you know how it goes.
I'm excited for you.
Thanks. Yeah, let us all know.
Okay.
All right. Anita, go ahead and ask your question.
Hello, everybody. It's great to be here again. And it's great to meet you, Zee. And I'm just blown away by all this. And I just want to like tap into a little bit of this information on a personal level if I could just have one nugget of where do I go to next? What is the next thing on my path that would really, I just feel like there's so much going on right now. And then I also want to know, do you actually do one-on-one sessions?
Yeah. So this is a general answer. I feel like for all of us is about reforming a relationship, a right relationship with ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
Just by asking this question, essentially, you know, we're literally born into a system that normalizes amnesia, normalizes having no idea who we are on a soul level. Our society says it's normal for you to not know who you are, what you want. We're trained and groomed to be that way so that we give away our power at every turn, right? We don't know how our body works. We don't know how to keep ourselves healthy. We need the government to tell us what to do in every turn. And so we're trained to do that. So when we wake up, we have to literally excavate and come back into relationship with ourselves, so that we know ultimately when we think about this architecture that's landing, right? We're creating, I feel like when people say the new earth is already here, I think what they're saying is that the new architecture of the universal consciousness has been set forth. Okay, so that means we all have to jump servers and subscribe to this new way of being. And so that means that what is highest for me in my timeline, it's what is highest for all beings. And so if I know that, then I have to just align with what is highest in myself. So that means what brings me joy, what brings me fulfillment, what makes me happy. And, you know, this is where a little bit discernment comes in between the AI and the organic consciousness, because the AI might be like, well, I want $10,000 or I want this fancy car, but really I'm talking about the desires of the soul deep, deep, deep inside of me, right? And this is a thing where it's like, well, I've always wanted to have a far. I've always wanted to rescue animals. I've always wanted to make music. So whatever those inklings deep in the soul that calls you, I feel like that's your portal into alignment. And it doesn't have to be the thing that you do for the rest of your life, right? It's just taking small steps to reclaim your connection with yourself. And that is a convoluted thing when we wake up, because, you know, the false matrix is just set up with so many booby traps. There's literal negative alien technology. I call it the anti-self virus, where we are trained and programmed to hate ourselves. We hate the way we look. We hate the when we will think we're dumb. We don't know how to do this. We think, you know, we judge ourselves. And all of that is not organic. When we start to do the healing work, you know, this is the stuff you throw up in ayahuasca ceremonies, right? and there's so many layers and levels to this. We really have to carry so much compassion and gentleness. And this is the stuff that, you know, we're holding space for, because it really takes a lot of time and a lot of precision and tenderness as we talk about this. We spiral through basically three rounds of this. The first round is more the human personality. The second round is going to be more the etheric, etheric bodies. And then the fourth round is going to be more of the template bodies. All of these layers of our being has been abused. And so, yeah, definitely coming into that place where you trust your feeling and trust yourself and believe in yourself and love yourself enough to feel like living a life that is joyful is normal. And we all deserve that. That's the creation that was designed and intended for all of creation, particularly relevant to this planet here that we're having.
Absolutely. That's it.
Thank you.
Yep. Thanks. See, amazing, amazing. So glad to have you here sharing all this awesome information. We definitely have to do some more of this in the coming, in the coming Sundays that we have. Any final words? I think we covered quite a gamut there, but any final words to depart with?
Have fun.
Yep, that's it.
Sometimes shit sucks, but it can still be fun. Like, I mean, there's a method to the madness. I feel like, yeah, my predominant work is in holding container for consciousness and DNA rehabilitation. And so, you know, there's a lot of intensity that goes into that, but also we provide a lot of tools, a lot of support.
Are you doing privates, or are you still just doing the seminars and things now, the workshops?
Well, I'm definitely one-on-ones. I might eventually do some, but really this academy is kind of, because the thing is that, like, it's all or nothing with me. Like, when I'm in there, I'm just like, okay, and then there's this, and then there's this, and then I want to collapse this thing, and we'll just be in there for like 3 years because this is our work. Right, right. So I'm like, how do I just create a healing container where I can bring you from place A to place B and hold space for whatever your soul needs? And that's why this came through with the guardians. It's a systematic process, because in sessions anyway, I'm basically repeating myself over and over and over and over again, because we're all born in the false matrix. And so we have a lot of the same systems of abuse. The part of my session that, of course, is not replicable is being able to read souls. But I noticed that even in my own sessions, it doesn't really matter if somebody else says things to me. They're like, oh, you know, you're a Pleiadian in the sixth dimension and you blah, blah, blah. It's like, unless I see it for myself, it doesn't really do anything. You know, it's just information in my mind. And then my ego is going to be like, okay, so I think Pleiadians dress like this. And then all of a sudden our 3D personality is like off on its own timeline, pretending to be a 6D Pleiadian when it's not an organic integration. And so.
Or a Blu-ray or, you know, one more and all those things.
Right. So I would much rather hold the container so that people are organically clearing their field. So they're naturally coming into connection with their multidimensional selves. And in a matter of, you know, 2 to 3 years, be an embodiment. And so
awesome.
Yeah, please let me know that you found me through Ruben. If you do want to join, just email me, because I definitely want to support Ruben's work. He's a great white brother.
Thank you. Thanks again, Z.
Thank you for having me.
And we'll continue this conversation.
Okie dokie.
Bye. Thanks for tuning in. Hope you liked this interview. We actually do this every week on my membership portal page. You can access it through interviewwithed.org or click on the link somewhere in here. I'll put a link and come over and join us. You too can ask questions. Every week we have new special guests and you get to ask questions directly to the channelers and to the beings that they channel. So see you in the portal.